Good morning, good afternoon, good evening, depending on wherever you are in the world. I just thought I'd do a short-ish video, or blog, or vlog, whatever you want to call it, in light of the maelstrom of emotions currently raging amongst social media on YouTube. Anger, pain, hurt, confusion. But on thinking about it over the last 24 hours and actually stepping away as much as I can now, I still think it's important that we all have opinions that we state, that we try to stay measured, and that we don't shout people down. And there's an awful lot of shouting, and there are an awful lot of people who come on YouTube for good reasons. So I'm going to err on the positive, if you like, when I say this. There are a lot of people who come on for good reasons, because they want to help. They want to help someone who has a missing loved one in their life, someone who is in pain, someone who's gone through hideous experiences and trauma, if possible, as best they can, and to be understood, and also, most importantly, as I've discovered in my life, you have to be heard when you are telling something. It is very precious to you, and all pain is very, very real, and it's every minute of every day. One of the things often not discussed is coping with not knowing what happened to a missing loved one. Many of us, hundreds, thousands of us, sadly, have experienced and are experiencing this horrible feeling of not knowing what happened to a missing loved one. And then what goes through your mind, your heart, how you cope, how you try to cope. Some people's missing loved ones are found and brought home safe, and some are not. But the damage, the pain never leaves. One of the really hard things about coping with not knowing what happened to a missing loved one is the uncertainty about the fate of the missing person. And many psychologists, from what I've read, feel that this is the worst kind of grief. Anyone involved in any kind of trauma or catastrophe might suffer emotional repercussions long after their physical needs have been addressed by emergency efforts. This psychological distress might be neglected by the crisis services, yet it is the mental impact which could in the long run be most disturbing. This particularly dreadful predicament is referred to by experts as ambiguous loss, because it remains unclear what has definitively happened to the missing person. So the psychology of hope is naturally activated. Hope becomes a two-edged sword, inspiring at times positive optimism and a desire to keep fighting on. But if or when hopefulness becomes dashed, perhaps even deeper despair follows. It is this turmoil of contrasting emotions endlessly oscillating between hope and despair, which renders this kind of grief particularly stressful and may prevent closure, as some call it, or finding mental peace at least. It could be asked which is worse, to know definitively that a loved one has been killed, or to not know what has happened, just that someone has gone missing. In a recent study called Missing or Killed, The Differential Effect on Mental Health in Women in Bosnia and Herzegovina of the Confirmed or Unconfirmed Loss of Their Husbands, they investigated this precise question by comparing the impact on two groups of women living in Bosnia and Herzegovina. Apologies, breathing's hard, bad today. Herzegovina. Those whose husbands were either confirmed as having been killed during the 1992 to 1994 war, who were at the time of the study officially still listed as, quotes, missing, quotes, as a result of said war. Researchers Steve Powell, Will Bartolo and Mary Hagel found the group with unconfirmed losses at higher levels of traumatic grief as well as severe depression. A study published in the journal European Psychologist found that the unconfirmed loss of a family member produces more distress compared with enduring a confirmed loss. The authors concluded that the particularly high levels of severe depression includes suicidal thinking, and in this group, it was especially worrying. Another recent study entitled, quotes, When Hope and Grief Intersect, Rates and Risks of Prolonged Grief Disorder Among Bereaved Individuals and Relatives of Disappeared Persons in Colombia, compared the bereaved with those who lost a significant other to disappearance, and found that the extent of hope in those dealing with the disappearance predicted prolonged grief disorder. Prolonged grief disorder is a grief reaction following loss characterized by intense longing and yearning for the lost person, combined with feelings of hopelessness and emptiness over a period of at least 6 months, if not longer. The study found that the more strongly people hope that their loved one is still alive, the greater the severity of prolonged grief disorder symptoms. Psychologists have attempted to study how to best counsel those in this predicament, and some have argued against delivering false hope. It may be there's a balance to be struck between trying to counsel against unrealistic or unjustifiable levels of hopefulness and crushing all hope. And whilst it may seem blindingly obvious what people are hoping for, as many of us know, the person being alive and well, this hope may evolve over time, for example, to praying that the missing person did not suffer. The problem is that when there is hope, it leads to incessant dwelling on the missing person, interfering, quite naturally, with daily life, and leading to a collapse in the long run. Sadly, we have become used to images of missing people collecting on street corners, etc., as signifying the hope of those searching for any news. It may be that this is the kind of heartbreak where uniquely hope potentially renders you worse. But many psychologists contend that ambiguous loss is much more common than people realise. For example, when a loved one develops severe dementia, there is a sense in which they remain physically present, but have in a sense also gone missing in terms of that person that you once knew. And speaking for myself, I know how that feels. Viktor Frankl, the famous psychiatrist who survived the Holocaust, argued that there can be no meaning to our lives without hope, and no hope without meaning. Frankl lived and worked among those for whom there surely could be no hope. They had lost everything and knew they were going to be killed. Yet he contended it was possible to find meaning to our lives, even in the face of the most brutal and inhuman catastrophe, as he himself had experienced at the hands of the Nazis. The art of survival would appear to hinge on how to find new meaning and hope in life, according to Frankl, and this might mean having to say goodbye when you remain unconvinced that you can be certain what happened to your loved one. And this sometimes feels like a betrayal. With any ambiguous loss, you are the one who has to make the choice to finally say goodbye. Whereas with every other kind of bereavement, that decision is forced upon you. But the fact the victim of ambiguous loss must have experienced love and attachment, for grief is the heavy price we pay for love, and is also perhaps something on which we can base our hope for the future, because that love made life worth it. The very reason for the despair is the foundation for hope for the future. So within my words, which I may or may not have said well, for which apologies, the key issue is to try to understand each other, try to hear each other, try to stop the noise, the strife, the babble. It is seemingly an uphill struggle. Well, it's gone beyond a hill, it's now a mountain. But we can do it, and we need to do it. We cannot carry on like this. So many of us, as I say, with so many good intentions, so many good people, we need the positive to start building and move away from the negative as much as feasibly possible. Love and compassion are necessities, not luxuries. And without them, humanity cannot survive. Dalai Lama. Take care. I hope something in my words helps or you find interesting. Be safe in this weird world that we're all living in. Much love, Carrie Pink.